The show is starting.
Than a speeding bullet, more powerful than a locomotive, able to leap tall buildings in a single bound, this amazing stranger from the planet Krypton, the Man of Steel, Superman, empowered with X-ray vision, possessing remarkable physical strength, Superman fights a never-ending battle for truth and justice, disguised as a mild-mannered newspaper reporter, Clark Kent.
Lois, what are you doing here?
Oh, just getting the woman's angle on this story.
The mechanical monster! Look out!
Thank you.
Now, you wait here. I'll phone this in. Yes, I'll give you the details later, Chief. All right, Lois. Lois! This is a job for Superman.
Story this is going to make.
The jewels. What have you done with the jewels?
You'll read about it in tomorrow's paper.
Are you going to tell me what happened to those jewels? Tell me. You'll soon change your mind. Superman. She's doomed.
That's a wonderful story, Lois.
Thanks, Clark, but I owe it all to Superman.
Finest in underground television.
The Raven. Once, upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary, over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore, as I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as if someone gently rapping at my chamber door. "'Tis some visitor," I murmured, "rapping at my chamber door. Merely this, and nothing more." Ah, distinctly I remember it was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow. Vainly had I sought to borrow from my books surcease of sorrow, sorrow for the lost Lenore, for a rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, nameless here forevermore. And the silken, sad, uncertain rustling of each purple curtain filled me with fantastic terrors never dreamed before, so that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating, "'Tis some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door, merely this, and nothing more." Presently, my soul grew stronger, hesitating then no longer. "Sir," said I, "or madam, your forgiveness I implore, but the fact is I was napping, and so gently you came tapping, and so softly you came rapping at my chamber door, that I scarce was sure I heard you." Here I opened wide the door. Darkness there, and nothing more. Deep into that darkness peering, long I stood there, wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming dreams no mortal ever dared to dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the stillness gave no token, and the only word there spoken was the whispered word, "Lenore." This I whispered, and the echo murmured back the word, "Lenore." Merely this, and nothing more. Back into the chamber turning, all my soul within me burning, soon again I heard the tapping, somewhat louder than before. "Surely," said I, "surely that is something at my window, that is. Let me see then what thereat is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment, and this mystery explore. 'Tis the wind, and nothing more." Open here, I flung the shutter, when, with many a flirt and flutter, in there stepped a stately raven of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obeisance made he, not a minute stopped or stayed he, but with mien of lord or lady, perched above my chamber door, perched upon a bust of Pallas, just above my chamber door. Perched and sat, and nothing more. Then this ebony bird beguiling my sad fancy into smiling, from the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore, "Though thy crest be shorn and shaven, thou," I said, "art sure no Craven, ancient, grim, and ghastly raven, wandering from the nightly shore? Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's Plutonian shore. Then the bird said, nevermore. Much I marveled this ungainly fowl to hear discourse so plainly, though its answer little meaning, little relevancy bore, for one cannot help agreeing that no living human being ever yet was blessed with seeing bird above his chamber door, bird or beast upon the sculptured bust above his chamber door, with such name as Nevermore. But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word, as if his soul in that one word he would outpour. Nothing farther than he uttered, not a feather than he fluttered, till I scarcely more than muttered, other friends have flown before. On the morrow he will leave me, as my hopes have flown before. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Startled by the stillness broken by reply so aptly spoken, doubtless, said I, what it utters is its only stock and store caught from some unhappy master whom unmerciful disaster followed fast and followed faster till his songs one burden bore, till the melancholy dirges of his hopes the burden bore of never, never more. But the raven, still beguiling all my fancy into smiling straight, I wheeled the cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. There upon the velvet sinking, I betook myself to linking fancy unto fancy, thinking what this bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, gaunt, and ghastly, ominous bird of yore meant in croaking nevermore. This I sat engaged in guessing, but no syllable expressing to the fowl whose fiery eyes now burned into my bosom's core. This and more I sat divining as I took my ease, reclining on the cushion's velvet lining with the lamplight gloating o'er, but whose violet velvet lining with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall press. Ah, nevermore. Then methought the air grew denser, perfumed from an unseen censer, swung by seraphim whose footfalls tinkled on the tufted floor. Wretch, I cried, thy God hath lent thee, by these angels, he hath sent thee respite, respite and nepenthe from thy memories of Lenore. Quaff, oh, quaff this kind nepenthe, and forget the lost Lenore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still, if bird or devil, whether tempter sent or whether tempest tossed thee here ashore, desolate, yet all undaunted, on this desert land enchanted, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, tell me, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me truly, I implore, quoth the raven, nevermore. Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still, if bird or devil, by that heaven that bends above us, by that God we both adore, tell this soul with sorrow laden, if within the distant Aden it shall clasp a sainted maiden, whom the angels name Lenore, clasp a rare and radiant maiden, whom the angels name Lenore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend, I shrieked upstarting, get thee back into the tempest and the night's Plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of that lie thy soul hast spoken. Leave my loneliness unbroken. Quit the bust above my door. Take thy beak from out my heart, and take thy form from off my door. Quoth the raven, nevermore. And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting on the pallid bust of Pallas just above my chamber door, and his eyes have all the seeming of a demon's that is dreaming, and the lamplight o'er him streaming casts his shadow on the floor, and my soul from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor shall be lifted nevermore.
Here before you is an opportunity to plumb the depths of the mysteries that confound and intrigue us. A chance to ask the big questions. Dr. Hal is not interested in questions of trivial matters or of facts that are easily gathered elsewhere. Dr. Hal seeks the questions that transcend fact. He stands before you ready to take questions that used to be brought to wise and aged sages on distant mountaintops. These questions can now be asked from the comfort of your living room. No Sherpas required. Simply direct your favorite web browser to ko-fi.com/askdrhal. You will be taken to a website where all you need do is submit your question in the provided message block and the value that you wish to place upon it. And Dr. Hal will answer your question in a way that only Dr. Hal can. Next, you will be asked for your email address. Don't worry, we never sell, share, or solicit. PayPal takes care of the rest and moves your valuable love offering from your hand to Dr. Hal. Simply enter your information and you're done. Wisdom will flow directly from Hal's lips to your ears. Links for this can also be found on the Ask Dr. Hal website at gonzotronics.net/ADH for Ask Dr. Hal. Do not let this opportunity to consult a modern-day oracle, a seer for seers, a man steeped in the arts, sciences, and esoteric studies pass you by. Now, through the very internet itself, comes to you the one and only Dr. Hal Robbins, now making house calls. Good evening, Dr. Hal.
Greetings, Pressure.
Wow, what a month. It's been We're operating on almost all new equipment over here. We had something, I don't know what happened here, but man, everything went sideways one day. And then we lost our pump, so I had to replace a pump too. That was pretty cool.
Well, these are the times that try men's souls.
It was a roller coaster this month. We thought we lost one of the hives, actually, and it turns out, though, the hive is fine. We went in and inspected it, and but we had a weird sort of thing happen with a visiting bee colony, it turned out. Very strange, but I'll maybe talk more about it later in the show.
I'm looking forward to that.
Very good. Well, we have a couple of questions in the queue, but I wanted to remind the audience that this is the Ask Dr. Hal show, so without your questions, we do not have a show. So please get your questions into the queue. Please use our website, ko-fi.com/askdrhal, and there you can place your question and, of course, your generous love offerings. Well, with that, Dr. Hal, would you like to get started, and we'll get a little bit into our question and answer session?
Why not?
Sounds like a plan. Well, I have one here. Let me see. I did want to say Dr. Billy sent one in. He's sponsoring a question this month. So perhaps Dr. Hal could wish Reverend Ramulak a happy birthday.
Oh, we do on the show. We wish him a most happy birthday and a year till the next one, at least.
Imagine that. Yeah, he's got some interesting things coming in his future, too.
not to tell tales. So you
are inclined to wax prophetic yourself?
Sometimes, uh-huh. but not this time. Well, you know, while we're mentioning birthdays, how about if I also mention that Reverend Peter Nostril is celebrating a birthday later this month, and belatedly, I'd like to say happy birthday to Dr. Ghoul, who
All right.
I believe just celebrated a birthday. So
it is the season, so we say happy birthday to all.
And if we've missed anyone, let us know. We'll be happy to wish you happy birthday.
That's right.
All right. So I have a question here from Frater Young Chihuahuasaurus. And yes. It is. I should mention. Hold on a minute. I'm forgetting my job here. It is a $13 question. Oh, very auspicious.
Yes.
And we know of the witching hour, when churchyards yawn and hell itself belches forth corruption into the world. But are there other similar segments of time? What happens during these times?
Well, insofar as the agents of the infernal region are ever able to erupt into our world, they need no special holiday to do so, nor is it really historically or even aesthetically correct, as certain Christian sects do, and I'm thinking of Jack T. Chick and his Myrmidons, to assume that Halloween is Satan's birthday. Of course, Satan was born before there were days, according to their own tradition, and so this is an entirely arbitrary assignation. There are such holidays in primordial Christianity as Rood Mass and Hallow Mass and so forth, but it seems, if you examine the calendar, that every day of the 365 days of the year is some sort of holiday for somebody. And why should Satan and his imps be left out? For them, any holiday is a chance to spread their revolutionary message. And if they seem to encroach more closely than ever, perhaps you can intuit or even know in some obscure way that the day on which this happens is a day perfectly suited to the operations of the forces of darkness.
I have a question here from Reverend Xenofact, and it is a $20 question.
Oh, very good.
And let me open it up here. Dr. Howe, you once wished for more discussion of mythic creatures. Therefore, I wish to ask you of cyclopses. The ones we see in mythology appear to be male. Do they have gender? And if so, do they reproduce? And how?
Well, the Cyclopes were giants. They were the sons of Poseidon, the lord of the oceans and of earthquakes. And they were quasi-human without achieving demigod or goddess status, simply known for their great size. And there were a number of varieties of them. Of course, Sinbad in the famous movie encountered a cyclops, and in the story of Sinbad also a cyclops was encountered, who was anthropophagous, like the one that Ulysses and his men encountered, although the description there varies, and some racism may have come into it. The same operation was used to dispose of the Cyclops, the blinding of the single ocellus, the darkening of the Cyclops' single and central eye, a disaster for them. Now, in the case of Polyphemus, after Ulysses escaped from the cave, where the Cyclops had been keeping him and his men captive, he taunted the Cyclops, and other Cyclopes came and supported the blind and stumbling Polyphemus. So we know that there were a number at that time. But where they formed as a usual regular birth, one must suppose that they were, since being humanoid, they no doubt had a humanoid point of origin. However, the females are hardly ever mentioned, if at all. And thus we may suppose that there was some exaggerated sexual dichotomy. Perhaps the female of the Cyclops is not even recognizable as such, and also differs in respect to size, just as the male spider is often a tiny thing, while the female is large and gross. This particular aspect of sexual dimorphism may have been reversed, but similarly expressed in the sons of Poseidon, the Earthshaker. Polyphemus often boasted of his patrimonial connections to Ulysses. And this happens even in the movie starring Kirk Douglas as Ulysses, if you've ever seen that. Well, a most generous contribution also. And so I will say a poem, an Australian poem. I will attempt an Australian accent because some of the rhymes don't work in a standard English pronunciation. And I'm momentarily unable to place the author of this poetic fragment, which is entitled The Bunyip and the Whistling Tea Kettle. Of course, I should mention that a bunyip is a cryptid water creature from Australian folklore, and a dangerous one indeed, as we shall find out. The Bunyip and the Whistling Tea Kettle. I knew a most superior camper whose methods were extremely wrong. He did not live on tea and damper, but took a little stove along. And every place he came to settle, he spread with gadgets, saving toil. He even had a whistling kettle to warn when it was on the boil. Beneath the Wateras and Wattles, Boronia and Coolibah, he scattered papers, cans and bottles, and parked his nasty little car. He camped, this sacrilegious stranger, the moon was at the full that week, once in a spot that teemed with danger, beside a bunyip-haunted creek. He spread his junk, but did not plunder, hoping to stay the weekend long. He watched the bloodshot sun go under across the silent billabong. He ate canned food without demurring and put the kettle on for tea. He did not see the water stirring far out beside a sunken tree. Then, for the day had made him swelter, and night was hot and tensed to spring, he donned a bathing suit in shelter and left the firelight's friendly ring. He felt the waters kiss and tingle. He heard the silence none too soon. A ripple broke against the shingle, and dark with blood it met the moon. Abandoned in the hush, the kettle screamed as it guessed its master's plight, and loud it screamed the lifeless metal far into the malicious night. Happy Halloween, and thank you for your question.
Wonderful, Hal. Well, you know, that's a tough one to follow, but it's about time for me to play our pressure point for this month. And it's
very good.
Well, it's a repeat, and the reason it's a repeat is because some of the things that I do is a repeat, and this month we made hard candy again for the bees. So rather than...
So only the bees got it, or did humans get to taste it also?
Oh, I put some aside for myself. It's actually really good. We followed we followed a recipe that we found that used some essential oils that made sense. We've been using a lot of lemongrass essential oil to attract bees. And they suggested adding it to this candy to make the bees more interested in it. So we put some of that in and a couple other ingredients, but it turned out very nice, and it makes very nice hard candy. It's delicious. So,
but well, maybe you'll have some to give away if the little nippers come by trick-or-treating.
Theoretically, I could give them some bees. That'd be fun. Let them take home little hives. Spread the wealth.
Ideally, the candy would not give them hives.
No, well, no. No, not ideally. But in any event, here is this here is this month's pressure point. What we are doing at the stove today is saving a little money by making our own concentrated bee food. The food in this case is good old-fashioned hard candy. Note my gloves and long-sleeved heavy shirt. I will be working with boiling hot syrup that will ultimately reach 310 degrees Fahrenheit or 154 degrees Celsius. This stuff is the closest thing to molten lava I work with in my kitchen, and I show it a good deal of respect. Really bad burns can result from carelessness or lapsed attention. I am really careful doing this. You should be too, and use proper equipment and safety gear if you attempt this at home. We started with 8 pounds of white sugar, 1 liter, or about 4 cups of water, medium heat, a big pot, and thyme. The sugar starts out as a slurry, but gets thinner as it heats up. It needs to be stirred gently and almost constantly. As it boils, it loses moisture and gradually thickens. The temperature also rises in the mixture, going from 212 degrees Fahrenheit or 100 degrees Celsius, you know, good old boiling, and rising up eventually to 310 degrees Fahrenheit or 154 Celsius, also called the hard crack stage. To get here, we pass through other useful candy making stages such as softball, hardball, and soft crack stages, all useful for making various confections, but today we want the hardest, driest candy we can produce. The process required a lot of stirring and tending. From start to finish, the hard candy, from granulated sugar and water to molten sugar hell, took about an hour. The mixture's temperature was taken at regular intervals and very closely monitored as the target temperature approached. The molten candy is poured into parchment paper lined cookie sheets and allowed to cool. While still soft, it is scored with a knife into squares to ease breaking when the mixture cools and sets. We will use the hard candy blocks as concentrated food for the bees, similar in composition to the nectars that they were extracting from the now mostly dormant plant life. We plan to supplement this with another favorite bee food, pollen cakes.
We are also adding a treatment to the hive for varroa mites, an invasive species that has been decimating colonies for some time now. We will also be watching out for a destructive little pest called hive beetles. We will be installing traps for them earlier next week. These traps, fortunately, don't use poison, but instead take advantage of the behavior of the pest and traps them in a pool of cooking oil. The mite remedy, however, does use a poison that is not harmful to the bees, but is definitely not healthy for the mites that are responsible for killing off colonies. Cold weather is approaching here in the Mid-Atlantic region. We are in Zone 7 for you gardeners out there. Rather mild winters compared to many, but we do get sub-freezing temperatures on a fairly frequent basis. We likely will not need to go with some insulating measures that other beekeepers need to take further north, but we will watch the weather over the winter with thoughts of our bees and will take special measures if conditions warrant. For now, we just want to feed the colony and assure that the bees have all the energy required to heat the hive. We are supplementing their stores, so to speak, to guarantee their best chance for colony survival and hopefully even thriving over the winter. Beyond some basic inspections and food supplementation as weather allows, we will be leaving the hives as undisturbed as possible. Oh, they've also kicked out all the male drone bees. This is a ladies-only party, and the food is all for the hive's survival. If they need a man, they'll make one. In this short clip, you can see that the bees have clustered closely together in order to generate heat for the colony's survival. A thermal imaging camera in this situation shows a temperature of 83.6 Fahrenheit or 28.7 Celsius at the center of the hive, while the outside temperature is 39.4 Fahrenheit or 4.1 Celsius on the outside. We will be back in the spring to see how the girls made out. So.
Well, that's good husbandry, and the bees seem content, and the candy looks very good.
It's delicious. It's wonderful hard candy. It makes great cough drops. So
did you get caramelization by heating the sugar to make
the
candy?
Yeah, and this year's is a little darker. I think I'm using a new thermometer, so the thermometer may not be quite calibrated where I'd like it to be. So
that adds to the deliciousness, of course.
Caramelization is a wonderful thing.
Wish them a pleasant winter.
Me too. Actually we're going to be insulating this year. So I'll probably be doing another video for next month of us doing all the insulation stuff for the hives. Last winter was a little colder than I wanted and the hives are going into it a little weaker than I'd like them to be. So we'll see how things look. So that'll be for another episode coming up, probably next month. So. Audience, I'd like to remind you to please get your questions into the queue. We will answer all of your questions this evening, so please let us know what's on your mind. Dr. Howe answers questions of cosmic significance.
Well, they all have that.
True enough. Well, I have more questions for you, Dr. Howe, and I have one here from Friar Quasar. It is a $10 question. And how many poems by John Donne do you know? D-O-N-N-E.
Do I know of, or am I able to recite as I think a question which I should ask there. I know of all Donne's poems for the most part, but as for being able to recapitulate them, I think I'm only good on one, and that is Death Be Not Proud. But some time I might attempt to memorize some of the longer ones. The second anniversary is a particularly illuminating one, which ranges over scientific, philosophical, and theological grounds, and is speculative and has a wonderful dynamism. But I would have to consult a book like anyone else to pull that one out, as it is quite long. He was the dean of St. Paul's Cathedral, you know. Also, he wrote poems of a sexual nature, since his sexual life was so varied. Known as one of the metaphysical poets, I believe, if I'm not mistaken.
Fascinating. I know Death Be Not Proud, but how does he have a large body of work?
Oh, yes.
I'm not certainly terribly familiar.
Huge phone book thick amount. And like John Milton and others, he wrote poems in Latin and so forth. But they're all good, I think.
Most excellent.
Worth looking into.
Always learn something new.
Particularly the second anniversary of The Progress of the Soul, occasioned on the death of Mistress Elizabeth Drury. Mm. I could always get it out and read it on some show, but I do not have that one to memory.
Hmm. Yeah, is it a long poem?
It is long.
Maybe we
long
should,
and expressive.
Maybe we should do a recording of that sometime in the near future.
That is possible.
Hmm. That would audience, let us know if you'd like to hear Dr. Howe do that.
I don't know if the audience would necessarily like it, but I'm sure some of them would. I know long poems by John Milton, which I've never tried with this audience, but in the future, we'll probably start running out of poetic material, and we'll have to come around to the ones that we haven't tried.
Friar Quasar said he would pay you for that.
For which? For the second anniversary of The Progress of the Soul, or for some of other Milton's other poems, such as L'Allegro, Il Penseroso, or the hymn from On the Morning of Christ's Nativity.
Oh, there, yeah, apps. Yeah, I think any of that would be
well,
awesome.
Well, they're all good.
Awesome stuff. Anyway, but I have another question for you.
Well, let's have it then.
This is a $25 question from our good friend Dr. Penny, who asks, why is Slack not possible without the perfect hamburger?
Well, Dr. Penny, I believe the hamburger has been used as a metaphor in the church writings, and one should not take this too literally, unless the perfect hamburger exists as an ideal, since perfection can never really be reached and is more of a pole star toward which we aspire, since after we do so, we are closer to it than we would have been otherwise. And yet, like Achilles' tortoise, we never actually reach that point. One may envisage the ideal hamburger as well as one envisages any other ideal. Perhaps slack is more likely to be achieved when one is happy with the hamburger that one has, or if the hamburger that is in one's possession does not satisfy the basic desires which inspired its creation, then in order to achieve slack, some effort must be extended to refine this culinary creation and to make the hamburger optimally best, even though it may not be the perfect hamburger that Plato would posit exists in the transhuman world of perfection. I don't know if this would count then as an answer or a non-answer to your question, but we appreciate opening the subject. And remember, the perfect hamburger is as perfect as one's satisfaction with it. In the Church of the Subgenius, we famously say, don't just eat a hamburger, eat the hell out of it. Which might also be phrased as be awake, be conscious, be happy in what you do. Since you must do things, let us be content by doing them and ju thus achieve slack, not only as an end product, but a byproduct, and swim in perfect confidence in a surrounding sea of slack. Here is a poem called The Listeners. Is there anybody there? Said the traveler, knocking on the moonlit door, and his horse in the silence cropped the grasses of the forest's ferny floor. And a bird flew up out of the turret above the traveler's head, and he smote upon the door once more. Another time. Is there anybody there? He said. But no one descended to the traveler. No head from the leaf-fringed sill leaned over and looked into his gray eyes where he stood, perplexed and still, but only a host of phantom listeners who dwelt in the lone house then stood listening in the silence of the moonlight. To that voice from the world of men stood thronging the faint moonbeams on the dark stair that goes down to the empty hall, hearkening in an air stirred and shaken by the lonely traveler's call. And he felt in his heart their strangeness, their stillness answering his cry while his horse moved, cropping the dark turf neath the starred and leafy sky, for he suddenly smote on the door even louder and lifted his head. Tell them I came, and no one answered, that I kept my word, he said. Never the least stir made the listeners, though every word he spake fell echoing through the stillness of that dark house from the one man left awake. Aye, they heard his foot upon the stirrup and the sound of iron on stone, and how the silence surged softly backwards when the plunging hoofs were gone. Thank you for your question. That was by Walter de la Mare.
Beautiful, Hal. Thank you.
Or is it de la Mare? I don't know how to pronounce his name. So, well, there we are. We have the large questions, and I recite a poem, but I'm sure it's not the worth of the questions, but I suppose the donation that inspires the re recitation. Anyway, let's see what else we have.
Well, actually, Dr. Howe, I'm going to give the queue an opportunity for the audience to add some more questions to it. Audience, we have more time. Friends, guests, and colleagues, if you could ask those mind-shattering questions to Dr. Howe at our website, ko-fi.com/askdrhowe. And
Or bland, ordinary questions. They don't have to be mind-shattering. It's up to me to make the answers interesting. So don't worry too much over whether the question is suitable. It will only be suitable if I answer it. And indeed, it'll be suitable if I can't answer it.
We
So
have
please ask them.
you have answered questions on pen ink, and that was fascinating. So any yes, you are correct. So audience, get those questions in. But for now, we have our first guest here tonight. We have Reverend Bender, Subgenius
Oh,
Strongman, and
yes.
it is
Mighty
a
man of valor in the Church of the Subgenius.
it's a video I've wanted to show for a while, but it has a little lead in, So, this will give an opportunity too for our audience to get some questions into the queue. So here
comes. There's no fakery here, ladies and gentlemen. What you will see is absolutely real. So let us proceed with this segment.
Ladies and gentlemen, Reverend Bender.
Chicago Yellow Pages.
Stay strong. Ah, those phone books are becoming a historical artifact. There are many who never heard of the phone books these days. And what will strong men of the future do? Try to tear a computer screen in half? Perhaps, maybe so.
I'd actually pay to see that on some days.
Well, then the progress of carnival entertainments has not been halted.
Bender, if you're out there listening, that would probably be dangerous, though. I would say gloves and safety glasses, definitely.
Well, yes, of course. But it's possible in attempting to tear a phone book in half or bend a steel bar that instead you might dislodge your muscles from their moorings. Something has to give. And so the strong man's art is an art indeed, tempered with caution.
Reverend Bender appeared at the last Starwood over the last summer. And
did he perform feats of valor?
He did, and he brought people up from the audience and was teaching people in the audience how to bend nails and so forth. And St. Joyce managed to bend her nail.
That could be handy if one doesn't have a pair of pliers.
That's true.
With one.
I'm going to get Joyce now to tear those out with her bare hands.
Hmm.
She's tough. Anyway,
I have your P's and Q's.
I have a question here for you.
All right, very good.
This is a $7 question, and it is from a username. And let me open it up here. When confronted with corruption or bias in a judge or authority figure, any recommendation or suggestion as to how to navigate treachery? I remain openly defiant and cling to the truth as they flood the zone with BS.
Well, when officialdom is corrupt and renders a decision in your case which is corrupt, one does not ordinarily have any compensation, any recompense for this. There is the process of appeal. And in going through another court, one could find another judge. But on the other hand, anyone who's been through the legal mill knows that it is a long and primarily costly process which can bankrupt one. It is more important for the individual to keep in a private part of his or her mental being a knowledge of what the true state of things is, and to be able to define the particulars of one's case, even though it may have been officially misrepresented in the records of the court. But write it down yourself so that you are not animated merely by a feeling of resentment, however justifiable. Make your case. And indeed, I would suggest that you do this as an exercise before you even go into the court, so that if given an opportunity to recapitulate your grievances, you can go directly to the point and perhaps even convince the most hostile legal mind of the verity of what you were trying to convey, although if they are indeed corrupt with them, that night might not matter.
I have a question.
Sorry, that's happened to you. Sorry, please go on.
I have a question here from you, from AgriJack. And let me open it up here. According to the winners of the 2022 Nobel Prize in Physics, nothing is locally real. Why then do I still have to pay for a locally made sandwich, which is not only not real, but mostly contains empty space? Would you like me to reread that?
I think I've got it, but why don't you, just so the audience can be assured.
So enlightened. According to the winners of the 2022 Nobel Prize in Physics, nothing is locally real. Why, then, do I still have to pay for a locally made sandwich, which is not only not real, but mostly contains empty space?
Well, a most interesting question. And we now know in high energy physics that things are not as discrete as long believed, as Einstein believed. It is possible that there is action upon disparate elements of matter at a distance through an unknown process whose origins are beginning to be suspected. Perhaps in string theory, we have a ghost of the explanation. But of course, the total reality does not therefore lie in the immediate vicinity and in those objects or portions of our environment that we can contact. They are dependent on everything else. And in nature, everything is dependent on everything else. Your hamburger may contain infinite volumes of space, but then it's not the space that you are consuming, but that amount of residual hamburger matter that is in it. And that should be your focus on contemplation, not necessarily to think how you're being cheated by not having the vacuum filled with hamburger atoms, but enjoyment that you can derive the hamburgerishness of the presentation which is offered. And indeed, a hamburger which was entirely occupied on the atomic and subatomic level might not even be edible. It might be so dense of atomic matter that it would sink down through the crust of the earth to come to rest somewhere at the core of Earth's molten center, where it would either be consumed by the heat or overcooked.
Dr. Howe, I'm not sure if I mentioned, but that was a $15 question.
Oh, $15 question. Well, the answer may once again have fallen short of in entertainment value. Let me throw in two Halloween-like limericks by Edward Gorey. Here's one. Each night, Father fills me with dread as he sits at the foot of my bed. It's not just that he speaks, but in gibbers and squeaks, but for 17 years, he's been dead. And here is one other by the same author. The partition of Vassavour scowls was upsetting. They turned up his bowels in a firkin. His brain was found clogging a drain, and his fingers were wrapped in some towels. Thanks for your question. Well, where are we now?
Well, we are about to go into our first monster movie moment.
Oh, yes, the monstrous monster movie moment. Now, we might have been pulling our punches with some of our beloved classic monsters, but we decided to get a little bit more grim with the selections we're offering in this show. So let's have the first of these.
Yes, and audience, this is the Ask Dr. Howe show. You have to ask. So get those questions into the queue. We can get them onto tonight's show. We do have room in the show. So audience, I implore you, give us some questions. That's what we do. So, Dr. Howe, here is our monster movie moment.
Very good. Oh, there you are. I was just searching for our next monster movie moment, and we have a corker for you from The Gate, directed by my good friend Tibor Takacs. You see, when some inquisitive youths play a heavy metal album backwards, they, well, we'll just have to see what evil is released. I think you'll enjoy the results. A problem in childcare is occurring, but is disrupted by the appearance of a horrible dead lich summoned by the powers of darkness. Always hit him in the head if you can. It usually works, as in this instance. But when he falls forward, he transforms into a series of imps or minions of evil, which absolutely infest the room. Just look at them. Not a pretty sight, are they? And they have certain malevolent intentions, which should be countermanded at all costs. Don't let them get through.
It's the first human sacrifice.
But this is all a prologue to the appearance of a major demon raised by the boy's activities. You know those movies where the parents go away and the kids make a huge mess? This is possibly that genre too. And so, later on, the imps make their return, this time to welcome their awful master, who has arrived to impregnate the innocent children with the force of knowledgeable evil. Here, they jump up and down, the minions, that is, the imps, in what passes for joy among the inhabitants of the dark world, because they know that a major archangel or demon is about to put in an appearance. Do you want this to happen in your house? There go the toys and comic books. They won't help you now. A visit from a supernatural being, not Santa Claus. The serpentine bulk of this creature stretches all the way down to the pit and up through the basement and the floor of the house, which will be hard to repair. Gonna try to get away, are we? Unfortunately, this is what can happen when you don't watch out. Beware the demonic high five. Now, you shall become essentially a transponder of evil. Always looking for you, always seeing, always watching you. Yes, the boys have a hole dug in the backyard, which unfortunately goes way too deep. But that movie and its sequel are very watchable.
I haven't watched the sequel yet.
Well, the sequel doesn't have Stephen Dorff in it, who got his career start as a child actor in the first movie, but later became a protagonist in other films. It rather follows the career of his assistant or buddy who runs afoul of some juvenile delinquents who attempt to use the dark forces for their own aggrandizement, particularly when they go into a restaurant and pay for an expensive meal with money they have supernaturally achieved. And when the waiter comes, the money suddenly turns to shit, literally. Anyway, many interesting scenes happen in that film too, but we may show it at some future time.
I will have to look into that. I've not seen it, so I will.
Well, both of them have very excellent stop motion effects, such as we saw there.
The scene where the zombie creature falls over and bursts into 20 of those little imps is stunning.
Yes, if you stop it and attempt to watch it, you still cannot see the motion where it dissipates into the many imps.
It's gorgeous. It's a cool effect. I have a couple of questions for you here. Audience, please get those questions in. Ask Dr. Howe something.
Or we'll just have a short show because there are an inadequate number of questions. Anyway, we'll see what the future holds for us all.
I make no predictions. Let's just drive smartly forward. Okay, I have a $3 question from Dr. Penny. And that question is, what is the secret to keeping one's bedroom clean and tidy?
Oh dear, I wish I knew that secret. My bedroom is neither clean or tidy. I've had to give up sleeping in my bed. I have to lie on the floor between piles of books and instruments, which is surprisingly comfortable. But if I could do things as I would like, I would actually sleep in the bed, an incredibly comfortable place to be. And yet for me, it is not to be. I would have to say, ruling on my own case, as well as speaking generally, that the best way of keeping your habitat clean and tidy is to have enough room for your stuff. I would never condemn anyone for having too much stuff unless this stuff is like old boxes of used Kleenex or the sort of thing that the hoarder traditionally has. But on the other hand, space is a luxury in this world, particularly as the real estate values have driven people into more and more compromised housing. I may have piles of books, but it's very difficult to access the ones on the bottom. Still, persevering this way is for me an act of optimism, hoping that in the future, some change, which I cannot visualize now, may enable me to expand my operation and have them all up on the shelf. And not only that, all my effigies of dinosaurs, laboratory equipment that I'm not using, everything that I've got crammed in here may have breathing room, and then it will be easy to clean. Until then, all you can do is keep the outer surfaces of things clean. And it is important to do so, particularly if you are in an old building where dust regularly falls, almost like snow, to coat everything in case you never have the opportunity to do anything about it. I'm sorry if you yourself are experiencing anything similar. And although I've been able to provide a solution, I still am unable to reach that solution myself. And if it applies to you, you have my sympathy as well.
Well, Dr. Hal, I'm going to give the queue an opportunity to grow. Audience, please get those questions in co-fee.com/askdrhal. Any love offering is fine. Oh, I failed to mention you can also enter questions in our chat area, and our lovely stage ghost St. Joyce will make sure those questions get to me. So
that's very good. And I think also we had something to say about things that the show has been mailing out. Do we not?
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Hal. We the house pressure was set by a series of weird little disasters all month, and we did not get our mailings out this month. So if you are expecting something from us, it has not been mailed yet, and I do apologize for the delay.
But it will be in the fullness of time.
It will be going out as soon as possible. So
yes,
be looking for it. And if you don't see it, don't worry. If you're concerned, drop me an email. pressure@gonzotronics.net. There. All right. Well, Dr. Howe, I have two videos that I'm going to be showing here. We have a musical guest this month, Rubik's Pube.
Oh, they're wonderful. They were at Real X Day, where we both were, as you may remember.
Yes, they were. A most excellent band, and wonderful to listen to. And I have them all gathered here for us this evening. Following that is going to be our second monster movie moment. So I'm going to play them back to back, and we will see you in a few minutes.
Very good.
Yeah. Are you tired of the same old shit? Looking for a show that's all too real? Rubik's Cube offers a newer, sexier salvation for extremists and outcasts. Involve yourself or turn off your device now. Become a pubescent, a solver. Learn the basics of time travel. Start broke and end rich. Figure out which elder god has it out for you. Become enlightened or severely agitated. Booking at rubikscubepa@gmail.com.
And now, our second monster movie moment. Even from the tomb, the voice of nature cries. Even in our ashes live their wonted fires. The necromantic alchemical process of palingenesis is the basis of H.P. Lovecraft's novel, The Case of Charles Dexter Ward, in which evil sorcerers can reanimate the dead from their ashes, just as in earlier alchemical experiments, the form of a rose, after it was burned, was recreated. The sorcerer Joseph Curwen did this with human corpses, with such results as we will see.
I am convinced that Joseph Curwen is indeed practicing witchcraft. I counted two deliveries made on the 9th. The first was a load of slaughtered cattle directly to the front door.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Each night thereafter, more cattle were delivered by the Negro they call Old Asa. The next delivery came in the boat of two Chinamen who brought with them what can only have been coffins. But it was on the morning.
The ancestor of Charles Ward observed coffins being taken to Curwen's house, coffins containing the dead who could be revived and made to talk. Bodies of philosophers and wizards.
12 October.
And this, the hole into Curwen's underground extensive laboratories, built by slave labor in those days, part of H.P. Lovecraft National Monument. Unfortunately, river rains washed some of the discards from Curwen's experiments into the river, which the city fathers with billhooks removed from the stream. These are palingenetic experiments which, unfortunately, had their ashes mixed. One needs the pure and entire ashes of the deceased, and when you mix them up, you get monstrous liveliness.
That abomination.
These beings cannot die.
Burnt by the High Sheriff.
There's only one way to destroy them, and that is by the cleansing power of fire. But now, let us flash forward to the 20th century, when investigators descend into Curwen's still existing world and discover some of these liches walking around. They were kept in a pit, but of course they had centuries to find their way out. It's good that Mrs. Ward sleeps through this unpleasant encounter. Back into the pit you go. Stay down. The thing to do, the prudent thing to do, is to take Mrs. Ward and get back to the surface no matter what. If only the flashlight batteries had not been purchased at a convenience mart past their expiration date.
What about Lonnie?
There's nothing we can do.
We must return to an earlier level of technology, the Lucifer match, of which there is only one.
Damn it!
According to the secret lore, the alchemist who first successfully performed palingenesis on the subject of the rose is the one known as Borellus, Giovanni Borelli. But I invite all who follow the show to do the homework on that one. So there we have the resurrected, a version of the case of Charles Dexter Ward. And earlier, many years earlier, Roger Corman's cheapo unit did it with Vincent Price. And what did they call it? The Haunted Palace, based on Poe's poem. Yet Lovecraft was the basis. Well, I trust our monster movie moments, as unsavory as they may be, have been appropriately flavored for the Halloween season. Let's see, how many questions do we have, or do we have any left?
I shook the queue and a few fluttered out. I was
very good.
Wow, it was like magic. So
enough to keep us going, staggering along.
We can do this, Dr. Howe. We can do this.
Of course we can.
I have a question here from Reverend Wolfgang Amadeus Gotterdammerung.
Oh, good.
It is a $12 question. Is there any prehistoric relative to the common chicken?
Well, actually, when one says prehistoric, the answer is always yes, because historic times are only the thin skin upon the monument of time, which goes all the way down to the bottom through eons, through lustrums and epicycles of cosmic time. And in the Mesozoic period, there was even a Galliform ancestor recently discovered. Yes, the ancestor of a chicken seemed to share its world with the last great saurians of the secondary age. But there are those who would say that the chicken itself is such a remnant. Viewers of this show know that this is one scientific proposition which I, Dr. Howland Owl, do not agree with. And I am not the only one. But what you hear about how chickens are actually dinosaurs is propaganda shouted by those with the loudest voices in the room. When you examine the anatomy, there are superficial similarities, but these can be explained by convergent evolution, while there are other profound differences which are hard to explain away. And so the cladists, for so we must call our opponents, simply ignore anything which does not agree with them, somewhat similar to the Republican Congress in that way. In fact, this entire deauthorization of fact and truth seems to be a sort of a rot flowing from Newt Gingrich out into all areas of society, civil, literary, and sadly, even scientific. But yes, there was a Mesozoic chicken, and there were ancestors of domestic fowl before historical records began to be kept, before ancient Egypt, which was ancient even in the time of Herodotus, as that Greek historian makes out, and earlier cycles of civilization, the earliest known being Mohenjo-Daro in India. That place also showed evidence that chickens were being raised. And why not? The chicken is a commensal species, and it is productive of eggs, which are delicious, and it is itself delicious. And so by some sacrifices of the population, the species itself is guaranteed to exist as long as humans exist, with the possible codicil that we may be able to grow artificial chicken meat in a laboratory with some sort of biogenetic process of generation. Did I answer that one? I meant to say, yes, there were chickens. There have been chickens, and perhaps there will always be chickens. Perhaps chickens will peck at the skeleton of the last human. Now, the future is unknowable in that regard.
They're like sharks, the perfect animal.
I was thinking did I dream that I was having a conversation with Colonel Harlan Sanders of Kentucky Fried Chicken? Then I realized, no, I actually did. You see, what happened was that Burning Man this year, which I attended, there was a Kentucky Fried camp where there was a person who impersonated the colonel, with whom I had an interesting conversation on the Black Rock Playa. Oh, well, let's go on to another question and ideally another answer.
Yes, we have a few that I have for you, actually. And
very good.
Let me see. I have one here. It is from a Ko-fi supporter, and it is for $12.
Again, that interesting number.
What do you feel is the most correct, true, beautiful, or otherwise satisfying interpretation of Blake's Ah, Sunflower, and why?
Well, good poetry does not have a single interpretation. Many people think it does because they've been through English classes in middle school or somewhere, which the suggestion seems to have been made that there's some secret or esoteric meaning that has to be teased out. But poetry has the ability to express multiple levels of meaning. Let's examine the poem in question. Ah, sunflower, weary of time, who countest the steps of the sun, seeking after that sweet golden clime where the traveler's journey is done, where the youth pined away with desire, and the pale virgin shrouded in snow arise from their graves and aspire where my sunflower wishes to go. You see, the sunflower actually turns as the day continues to follow the passage of the sun through the heavens, from which it derives its energy and with whose help it manufactures chlorophyll in its secret chambers. I've often thought that if they aren't doing it already, they should design solar arrays which do the same thing, which have a part which focuses on the location of the sun and tilts the solar cells to follow it. Surely some small amount of the energy received could be devoted to this practice. The poem also seems to suggest the last judgment. At the end of days, when the dead, according to Christian theology, are resurrected, come from their graves and put on new flesh for their afterlife. And the sun then is a symbol of the creative principle in this interpretation, the imminent will that stirs and urges everything, which in the case of the sun is followed by the attentive face of the flower, and in the case of the human may be or ought to be followed by one who sets his or her eye on things beyond the common elements of life.
That was quite an answer.
Oh, well, I hope that meant it was an adequate answer.
Oh,
let's see if we can do well with the next one.
This is a $3 question from Friar Quasar, and it's something I think we all want to know. What are you going to be this year for Halloween?
Well, you know, I haven't given that question any thought, Frater Quasar. I'm not even sure I'm going out to do anything for Halloween, unless, of course, I'm called upon to appear at some Halloween celebration. You see, Halloween is not just a single day for some of us, but an entire season. And for some of us beyond that, the entire year is tinged with a sort of Halloween sensibility. I don't really have any costume handy at hand, but if I needed to put something together, I could go as something. Now, in the past, especially in my juvenile days, I created many elaborate outfits. Once I went as a headless person, building a false shoulders and neck above my own shoulders with false arms, you know, using a detergent box, a large one, but I was a smaller person in those days. And another time I went with an alien with a death ray made out of vacuum cleaner parts, as I recall. But no such effort has occurred recently. And although one's costume, if cumbersome, may give those who see it pleasure, it is difficult to attend a party when one is entirely concealed beneath some elaborate getup. Perhaps then the light mask of a dilettante is more useful, which may be temporarily held before the eyes. But the ideal, the object of dressing up and posing as someone else, particularly someone else who you identify with, is a profound thing which everyone should try. I suppose that I should be asked at our next show if I did get myself up as anyone or anything else, and I will be happy then to provide that answer, which at the present time is, of course, unknown to me.
I have a $3 question from Reverend Jack D. Fontenot. And the question is, what is a question that you wanted asked haven't been?
Well, that's a good question, Reverend Jack. I'm not sure that I've ever been thirsting for a specific question to be asked. I rather try to keep in trim so that I may answer any question which is asked, and I tend to forget them once I answer them. One cannot dwell on one's track record, but one must anticipate the future and try to think ahead. Questions about historical facts that I know are always pleasant to answer, at least more pleasant than those which I do not know, and where I have to infer or devise an answer which seems appropriate. This is the same with science, with art, with all fields of human endeavor. But I could also, with easy celerity, answer a question about things that I myself have done which might require clarification. And in that instance, of course, therein I am the unrivaled expert. The purpose of this show is to entertain by providing answers. These are guaranteed to come. There will always be an answer. Whether the answer is appropriately correct is a matter to hash out later. But we try to be as correct as we might possibly be. Asking questions about my particular field of obsession might be good. You could ask me about King Kong and Skull Island, his old stamping ground, things like that. I do delve into esoterica. I can describe battle with the sea monster with Ruggiero riding the hippogriff and what the hippogriff was like. I have spoken in the past about the Arimaspians and their robbing of the treasure hoards of the griffins and so forth and so on. My head is filled with that sort of thing. And yet, in the past, when I have brought it up at subgenius palaver opportunities, sometimes this has seemed to produce irritation in those who heard it. My friend K-Rob has been bored almost to falling asleep by it, and Stang once reprimanded me from veering off in that direction. However, here on this show, I may dilate endlessly on these topics, so I can only say, be careful what you ask for.
I have a $3 question from Reverend Zeno. Yes, Reverend Xenofact, and it is Dr. Hal. What is your favorite kind of curry, and where do you find it?
I do like curry. And curry is a very healthful thing. Everybody should eat it because of the turmeric involved. And one can usually find curry in an Indian restaurant. One would expect to find it there. One also finds it in a Chinese restaurant, although some people might claim that the food is inauthentic since curry is known to be innocent and Indian, I mean, and not Chinese, to which my response must be balderdash. The idea of authentic food goes by the board. A Chinese restaurant is a Chinese-American restaurant, just as a Mexican restaurant is a Mexican-American restaurant. And these eateries produce viands which cannot be found at the original sources and may indeed be an improvement on their original genesis. But now let me tell you of my favorite curry and where to find it. In an issue of the New Yorker many, many years ago, the son of Alger Hiss wrote a lead story, which was in the talk of the town in the New Yorker. Does my audience recall who Alger Hiss was? No time really to go into that, except to say that Richard Nixon attempted to prove that he was a communist in the U.S. State Department. Some people says he was and Nixon was right. Other people said it was the sort of typical Republican thing and not such a slam dunk. But the son of Alger, Tony Hiss, wrote this piece about the Hunan restaurant in San Francisco, which he called the greatest Chinese restaurant in the world. Now, back in those days, I had a job. Yes, don't look so shocked. I was actually employed with my friend, now deceased, Merle Regal. I worked as a film inspector. This is all kind of beside the point, but a film inspector would, as the name suggests, inspect films. There was no internet. There were no DVDs. If you wanted to watch a movie, you had to have a projector and film. And of course, one of the perks of this job is that you could drag home on the bus a bulky projector and large reels of film and watch a movie in your own house. These movies were sent out to places that didn't have projectors or sometimes they did have projectors, but they were not movie houses. They were like Indian schools in the desert and things like that. And after The films, rented from West Coast Films, the place we worked before, came back. They were often scratched and with sprocket damage. Parts would have to be cut out and replaced, and splices would have to be put in. We would run the films through the machine, and that is how we would pass our days. But at lunchtime, we would go up on Kearney Street and go to this restaurant, the greatest Chinese restaurant in the world, which was Henry Chung's Hunan Restaurant. Only about 35 people could fit in there at any one time, but they had a marvelous method of producing the spiciest and most delicious Chinese food anywhere, ever. Now many years have passed. Water has rolled under the proverbial bridge. Henry Chung and his wife Diana, his son Marty, others have been gathered to their ancestors. But as it was a family business, there are still some restaurants that run Henry Chung's special recipe of extreme spiciness and deliciousness. The one near me on Church Street in San Francisco is one that I always enjoy going to, and that I will take any visitor to who comes to visit. And their curried chicken is volcanically hot and incredibly delicious. This is my favorite dish involving curry of all others which might be offered. Forget what curry in some other Chinese restaurant has tasted like. This is the superior article, I can assure you. And on the wall in a dusty frame, you can see Tony Hiss's article, or a facsimile of it, which angered and irritated other Chinese restaurant owners in San Francisco by calling this one the greatest Chinese restaurant in the world.
Very good.
You should come to SF. I'll take you there if you like that sort of thing.
You know, of late, Hal, I've had to give up eating hot food.
Well, I don't know what kind of food you were eating, but the thing is that some hot peppers contain oil, which the digestive tract feels all the way, but others are drier, and it is a dry heat. And in the Hunan method, these peppers are chopped up into a fine mist and distributed in the food. The food is only cooked for about 18 seconds. Most of the time is spent chopping it and putting it in the red hot wok. But it is true that it's too much for some people. And so if you don't ask them, they won't give it to you as hot as it's supposed to be. You have to insist that you want the original Henry Chung recipe. But if you can't eat it, I understand that. They also have dishes which are spicy, but not hot.
Yeah, I used to like almost be like championship level hot food eating, but
with jalapenos.
I could eat jalapenos. Yeah, they were good.
Yeah. Those have the oil, but the dry peppers, the Chinese call them touch the sky peppers, are hot in their skins and seeds, but do not contain the oil of Mexican peppers, the habaneros and so on. I've been enjoying peppers sent to me by Ivan Stang, grown from the Stang Ranch, and these things are hard even for me to eat. They're super hot, but of course, super enjoyable.
I believe hotter climates do produce hotter peppers, and Stang has certainly had
they
that hot,
do,
dry.
Indeed. My father in World War II had a Mexican Jeep driver who would eat these hot peppers, and he once prevailed upon the guy to give him one, and it was not pleasant. There was, it certainly did burn in that case. He said, "Oh, senor, oh, lieutenant, I don't think you would like it, but..." And he was prevailed upon, and it was true. My dad didn't really like it that much when he tried it.
Yeah, I can imagine. I have shaken the jar, and I believe I have one more question here. Let me give the jar a shake.
The last question. We're coming up on 9 o'clock. Maybe this is only appropriate. And, of course, we hope to be joined in the chat room afterwards by those who have been with us this far. But let's see what this final question is like.
This is from our good friend, Reverend Goughlin. And it is a $15 question.
Excellent.
And it is, Dr. Hal. This year, myself and my true Yeti mate are celebrating our 15th wedding anniversary.
Oh, how nice.
What would make for a suitably subgenius celebration of the occasion?
Well, I know what I would do, although I never will, because I won't ever anticipate a 15th wedding anniversary. Though, who can say? What would be a subgenius celebration for me might not be a celebration for you, and so forth and so on. I can only be guided by what I would like to do, and that is to go to some sort of amusement park. Yes, this may seem like a crude method of celebration, but rather than going to a museum or going out to the movies or something, to be able to wander around, eat carnival food, funnel cakes, cotton candy, all that stuff, soft serve ice cream, ride on carnival rides, visit the fun house, all of that thing would be fun indeed. And subgenius as well, because these things are only as entertaining as one allows them to be, and to be a subgenius with the opportunity to extract slack from one's encounters with the rest of the universe, then that is to be able to enjoy the carnival and its delights to the full extent of possibility. Well, if there isn't an amusement park or a carnival near you, you could take a rain check on that. Second to that would be going to a remote and interesting part of nature to experience together. First, I recommend the human carnival, and then I recommend the outer world of growing and living things. And perhaps that would be even more fun in each instance than a night spent comfortably at home, although I don't denigrate that as part of the supreme enjoyment that is possible.
Well, Dr. Howe, I did just shake the jar one more time, and another question fell out.
Very good.
So I have this, I do believe this is the last question, but I will shake that jar again. This is a $23 question, and it is from Dr. Irreverend Professor Full Speed Gravity Breakaway Esquire. And the question is, can you give your thoughts on traditional / proper considerations before inviting a new partner to share one's home? My new partner appears to have no red flags, which makes me worry a little. She might be too normal.
Well, I'm not sure she might be, because if she has no red flags, then she's perfectly fine with whatever you differ from in the rest of society, and the rest of homes, with your subgenius presence. Most subgeniuses have in their home what Philo Drummond calls slack altars, shelves where there are objects of specific meaning, strange statues, odd things found from the natural world or from the human world. And these often cause the pinks and normals to shudder when they see them, since they cannot figure out or even remotely discern why they're in your house to begin with. Beware of a potential mate who seems all sweetness and light, but yet soon demands that all your subgenius things be removed to a little closet-like subgenius room, and the rest of the house a sort of bland showplace of bourgeois comfort and respectability. When this process begins, you will know that your subgenius nature is being challenged, and this is where you must put your foot down or put something down and to say, no, this is me, this Bob's Big Boy statue from 1953, toys from Canada, whatever these things are, have to have their prominent place, because from them, from the contemplation of otherness, from the understanding that other aesthetic systems produce them, a subgenius derives slack much more easily than he might derive slack just from sitting down and watching the latest show on Netflix. Not to say that there isn't slack hidden in there somewhere. A lot of these shows are produced by people who clandestinely acknowledge some subgenius affiliation. How much did you say that their question was sponsored with?
That was a $23 question, Dr. Howe.
All right. Well, in that case, I will throw in another a poem. We try to match Halloween with our poems. And I think I've said this one before, but your generosity was great. Your donation was large. And therefore, I will now subject you to the poem, The Insect God by Edward Gorey. Oh, what has become of Millicent Frastley? Is there any hope she is still alive? Why haven't they found her? It's rather ghastly to think that the child was not yet five. The dear little thing was last seen playing alone by herself at the edge of the park. There was no one nearby to stop her from straying off in the shadows and oncoming dark. Before she could do so, a silent and glittering motor pulled up where she sat nibbling grass. From inside came a nearly inaudible twittering. A tiny green face peered out through the glass. She was ready to flee, but the figure beckoned. An arm with two elbows held out a tin of cinnamon balls. She paused a second, reached out as she took one, and lifted her in. The nurse was discovered collapsed in some shrubbery, but her reappearance was not much use. Her eyes were askew, her extremities rubbery, her clothing was stained with a brownish juice. When questioned, with hopes of her answers revealing what had happened, she merely repeatedly said, "I hear them crawling about on the ceiling." She had gone irretrievably out of her head. All feelings of horror, resentment, and pity for things which so seldom turn out for the best. The car, unobserved, sped away from the city, while the last of the light died out in the west. The Frastleys felt sick with apprehension, which a heavy tea only served to increase, though they thought it hardly genteel to mention the loss of their child. They called in the police. Through unvisited hamlets, the car went creeping, with headlamps unlit and the curtains drawn. Those natives who happened not to be sleeping heard it pass and lay awake until dawn. The police, with their flashlights and notebooks, descended on the haunts of the underworld, seeking for clues. In spite of their praiseworthy efforts, they ended with nothing at all in the way of news. The car, after hours and hours of travel, came to a gate in an endless wall. It rolled up the drive and stopped on the gravel at the foot of a vast and crumbling hall. As evening wore on, hope started to languish, and soon was replaced with all manner of fears. The family twisted their fingers in anguish, or got them all damp with the flow of their tears. They removed the child to the ballroom, whose hangings and mirrors were streaked with a luminous slime. They leapt through the air with buzzings and twangings to work themselves up to a ritual crime. They stunned her and stripped off her garments, and lastly, they stuffed her inside a kind of pod. And thus it was that Millicent Frastley was sacrificed to the insect god. Happy Halloween.
Mm-hmm. That was lovely.
Well, it's been fun doing the show, and we hope you've enjoyed it. And will join us in November for our Thanksgiving number or whatever it is. And we urge you all to have a happy and thorough Halloween.
And the next show date, let me look at that real quick. It is going to be November the 13th.
How propitious.
November the 13th. So there. All right. Well, we had a lot of questions come in at the last minute, Dr. Howe. That was a fun segment answering all those questions at once. So we invite everyone to our after show chat. I did post the link for that in the chat area. However, if you need further instruction, you can go out to the website at gonzotronics.net/ADH4. Ask Dr. Howe. And so, well, Dr. Howe, it's we're getting to the close of the show, so that's all I have. If you have anything to add.
I don't think I do, but we do have a final recitation, I understand.
We certainly do. And I am going to get everything ready for that to be broadcast out to our audience. So, moving smartly forward. Dr. Howe, thank you everyone for participating in the show tonight. Thank you all for watching the show tonight. Equally important. And with that, good night everyone and happy Halloween.
Just a quick reminder that the Ask Dr. Howe show may be seen live on Twitch on the second Sunday of each month, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific, at twitch.tv/AskDrHowe. Please visit the Ask Dr. Howe website at gonzotronics.net/ADH, where you will find links for previous episodes of the show, as well as information on live performances. That address again is gonzotronics.net/ADH for Ask Dr. Howe.
Little Orphaned Annie. Little Orphaned Annie's come to our house to stay, to wash the cups and saucers up and sweep the crumbs away and chew the chickens off the porch and dust the hearth and sweep and make the fire and bake the bread and earn her board and keep. But all us other chillen, when the supper things is done, we sits around the kitchen fire and has the mostest fun a-listenin' to the witch tales that Annie tells about and the goblins that gets you if you don't watch out. And onct there was a little boy who wouldn't say his prayers, and when he went to bed at night, away upstairs, his mammy heard him holler, and his daddy heard him bawl, and when they turned the covers down, he wasn't there at all. And they seeked him in the rafter room, the cubby hole and press, they seeked him up the chimney flue, and everywheres, I guess. But all they ever found was just his pants and roundabout. And the goblins will get you if you don't watch out. And once there was a little girl who used to laugh and grin, make fun of everybody and all her blood and kin. And once when they was company and old folks was there, she mocked them and she shocked them and she said she didn't care. And then just as she kicked her heels and turned to run and hide, there was two great big black things a-standing at her side, and they snatched her through the ceiling, for she knew what she's about. And the goblins will get you if you don't watch out. And little orphan Danny says that when the blaze is blue and the lamplight flickers and the wind goes whoo, and you hear the crickets quit and the sky is gray and the lightning bugs and dew is all quenched away, you better mind your parents and your teachers fond and dear, and cherish them that loves you, and dry the orphan's tear, and help the poor and needy ones that clusters all about, or the goblins will get you if you don't watch out. James Whitcomb Riley.
Thank you for joining us this evening. Please join us for our after-show video chat. For links to this and more, visit gonzotronics.net/ADH for Ask Dr. Howe.